seminar speaker for our seminar series. We saved the best for last today. Leanne Gilbertson, and she's coming to us from the University of Pittsburgh. So she was very generous with her time and drove out here to see us. She's an assistant professor. She's been there for a year and a half. And she focuses in the environmental engineering program there at Pitt. Her research focuses on nanotechnology and materials, but also life cycle assessments and sustainability as applied to environmental engineering. And that in general is going to be the topic of her talk today. Her bachelor's degree is from Hamilton College, and that's actually our connection. We have a mutual friend at Hamilton, and maybe some other day I'll tell you that whole story. But she got a degree in chemistry with honors from Hamilton College, then went to work for a little bit, and then started a graduate program at Yale University in their environmental engineering program, which Yale houses under chemical engineering. So master's degree, two master's degrees from Yale?
They do something weird there.
I can't keep up with how many Yale. Two master's degrees from Yale, PhD from Yale, working in the same group that the speaker from Carnegie, or the speaker from Yale that was at Carnegie Mellon was at last week.
Oh, was that Megan?
Sorry. I've been told about many.
Got it, many. Yep. I worked in many's lab. Yes.
There you go. All right, so I've already taken up more of her time than I care to, so just please let's thank our speaker. All right.
All right. Thanks for that introduction and the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here, and I'm pleasantly surprised to see so many people here on a Friday afternoon. So hopefully not too many of you fall asleep and we keep this interesting. I'm trying to finish up with time left to have questions. But if you want to stick around, I'm not rushing out of here. If you wanted to chat a little bit longer, I'm more than happy to chat with any of you. So today, as Joe mentioned, I'll be talking about some of my work as it relates to nanotechnology and specifically the work I do with life cycle assessment. But before I get started, Dr. Goodwill, do you go by first names here? Or I don't know.
Either way is fine.
Okay. Dr. Goodwill, he mentioned that it might be worthwhile to just talk a little bit about my path to environmental engineering because, as many of you probably are learning, there's no one path to where you end up. And so I'll spare you the details of my childhood, and I'm going to start with Hamilton College, which is where I did my bachelor's degree. It's actually not much different than St. Francis here. It's a little bit smaller, and it does not have engineering. And so when I started at Hamilton, I was interested in sciences, and I really liked my high school chemistry class, so I took a couple classes in chemistry my freshman year. I really liked it, and so I ended up majoring in chemistry. It was as simple as that. So as a chemistry major, of course, I was introduced to research, so this is a snapshot of some of the research that I did. I was making these sol gels using rare earth metals, and I was adding some organic compounds onto the rare earths to try to capture more light. The light was then transferred to the rare earths, and they glowed these red and kind of greenish colors. They were europium and terbium, were the rare earth metals I was working with. So it introduced me to research in the lab and also to the nano field, because we were looking at how do the properties change when you go to the nanoscale. I was also really interested in teaching, and so I spent a lot of my time in their education department, which was in the attic of the chapel there, and I did a lot of student teaching at Clinton High School, again, not very different from the Loretto town here, very small town, and this really set me up to be a chemistry teacher for after I graduated. So that's what I went to do. I took a fellowship and went to Scotland. I was in Edinburgh, so this is Edinburgh Castle. This is the school that I was at, George Watson's College. And the pictures that I show here, and I wish I could put more because Scotland is such a beautiful country. But the main point I want to make is that it was while I was there, so I graduated, and I was like, I don't want to go to grad school, like, never. definitely not in chemistry. And so it was while I was there, you know, I spent the year, and it was much about teaching as it was about self-reflection. And I realized that I wanted to go back to school, and I discovered engineering, which I had been avoiding my entire life. And I found environmental engineering. And that really was a field where I felt I could apply my chemistry to solve challenges and research problems that were of interest to me. And so it was there that I started my application process, but coming back to the United States, after that experience, I was off cycle. So I filled my year by teaching at a school, St. James School, in Western Maryland. This is my AP chemistry class, so I taught chemistry and AP chemistry. There was a boarding school in Western Maryland. I was there for a very short time before going to graduate school. Okay, so a couple years teaching, and then as Dr. Goodwill mentioned, I was in the environmental engineering program at Yale University. And so the engineering school is here. I also spent a lot of time in the Center for Green Chemistry and Green Engineering. The marriage between chemical and environmental was a natural fit for me. So again, that ability to apply what I knew in chemistry to engineering. And while I had a lot of background in chemistry, I had no microbiology lab experience. So I did a lot of plate counting. I was introduced to microbiology, which has really become a cornerstone to the research that I do. And it was also while there that I was exposed to life cycle assessment. And I'll be talking a lot about life cycle assessment later on in my talk. And so these two components mixed with my chemistry have become sort of the, as I mentioned, the cornerstone or foundation to the research that I do now at University of Pittsburgh. So this is Oakland in Pittsburgh. Cathedral of Learning, and then back there is the Swanson School of Engineering. It houses all engineering departments on the 11 stories, and then in the basement we have a lot of characterization facilities. And I have a growing group, so I've been there for a year and a half. I'm mentoring some undergraduates. I have three PhD students in environmental engineering, and then a new master's student that I'm working with this year, Josh Urso. So it's a wonderful location. I'm more than happy to bring any of you, if you're interested in coming, to check it out. I have a slide at the end that introduces a lot of our faculty. So definitely take a look if you're interested in graduate programs. Okay, so the general overarching theme of my research group is the sustainable design of emerging materials and products. And the projects that I pursue generally fall into three main categories. So I focus on and study interactions of these nanomaterials with the biointerface, so this being E. coli here under a TEM microscope. And then I look at life cycle trade-offs and product design, and I've established this framework, which I'll talk more about later on in the talk. And then developing a materials design framework based on sort of upstream, the inherent interactions, and what they would, what the materials are being used in, the products are being used in downstream. And I'll talk more about this upstream, downstream in a little bit. This is a busy slide, but it gives you a one-slide overview of my work. So the engineered nanomaterials that I work with, starting with carbon-based nanomaterials, so carbon nanotubes and graphene, and trying to answer questions about how we can design them and manipulate and tailor their properties based on the structure and then the surface chemistry. I work with copper oxides, so metal oxides and metals. And here, we work with metals, or I work with metals that ionize, so that introduces another mechanism of interaction with organisms. And then also looking at things like shape and size. So these parameters that we have control over with the idea to identify those properties that can tailor an outcome that either we want or we want to avoid. Today's talk will really focus on my nano-enabled product and life cycle assessment work. So the utilization of these materials in products, sensors, textiles, fertilizers, and how we can design these products to maximize the net environmental or human health impact. So I thought that I would define nanotechnology and nanomaterials as it relates to my work, because you may have heard about both before, but the research or the talk today will make more sense to you if we kind of clear this up at the beginning. So nanotechnology is the manipulation of matter at the nanoscale. So it can be anything, right? But we're manipulating it at the nanoscale, 10 to the minus 9th meters. And the reason that people do this is to realize unique properties or novel functionality that you can't access at other length scales, so micron and larger length scales. So there's a lot of unique properties that we can realize in these manipulations at this scale. When I mentioned engineered nanomaterials, that's any substance or material having one dimension between 1 and 100 nanometers. Right? So nanotechnology and nanomaterials, these are the things we're making with these manipulations at the nanoscale. And I would challenge you to find a industry or sector where there is not currently a nanomaterial application or one that's being proposed. So the manipulations at the nanoscale have inspired a lot of fundamental phenomena. So there's a lot of fundamental scientists that are interested in answering questions there, but also a number of applications. And I'm showing a subset of industries that are touched by nanotechnology here. So energy and electronics, a lot with battery and energy capture and catalysis. Environment and agriculture, so we're talking about water treatment, membranes, talking about contaminant detection, crop protection. In medicine, they're using nanomaterials for therapeutic delivery, biosensors, wound healing. And then in homeland security, protective clothing, unmanned technology, and remote sensors. So these are just a few of the applications to give you the sense of the vast range of applications and products that nanomaterials are touching. Okay, so at the same time, there's concern over potential implications of nanomaterials. And this is primarily driven by the inherent toxicity that people have discovered. And there's been a whole field of research that is focused on understanding what the inherent toxicity and mechanisms of toxicity are of nanomaterials. And this is one figure that just demonstrates what some of the interactions are between our nanomaterials here, these being carbon nanotubes, and the cell, right? So we have a big cell, but to scale compared to the nanomaterials. Here we have them being engulfed into the cell. We have a lot of oxidative stress mechanisms. We can have binding with our DNA and RNA. So there's a number of different mechanisms by which nanomaterials can cause adverse impacts to cells and different organisms. And so the reason that people are concerned about this is, like any other hazardous chemical, there's potential exposure pathways both to the environment and to humans, all right? So nothing atypical here. You have your source point sources and your non-point sources. This being your applications, your wear and tear, or if you're directly applying nanomaterials to the environment, right? Then you have an exposure to the environment, of course, transformations and different reactions that can happen to transform your nanomaterials, and of course, human exposure through the pathways of inhalation, ingestion, and dermal exposure. Okay. In addition to those inherent toxicity and the exposure pathways, there's indirect considerations. So if we look at production of nanomaterials, this being specific to carbon nanotubes, but the plot showing your megajoules per kilogram of nanomaterials or carbon nanotubes being produced. And across the x-axis, these are your three different primary methods of making them. And the dotted lines here are different silicon and aluminum materials that are known to be very energy intensive. So the point being is that energy demand for creating carbon nanotubes far exceeds those of materials that we know to be incredibly energy intensive. And so the idea here is that it's not just inherent toxicity, but we're talking about other parts of the life cycle that can also have indirect implications. And then if we think about the other stuff, right, that goes into making here our carbon nanotubes, we're looking at manufacture, purification, and our final product. We have sources. So these are a lot of hydrocarbon sources, our metal catalysts, strong acids. We have VOCs, volatile organic carbons, that are being emitted as we make these carbon nanotubes. And so, you know, the point here being is that you're not just talking about your carbon nanotube that you're making, but you have all these other components that are going into synthesizing those tubes. And so you need to be concerned or consider the other potential implications or hazards of the materials you're using. Okay, so that introduction really set up the stage for where my research lies, and it's trying to harness all of the good that nanomaterials and nanotechnology has to offer while precluding or avoiding all of the bad. And this is where design comes into play. And so how do we do things differently with nano? And I'm just going to go through a few examples of what not to do. So fortunately, we have some examples to draw upon, but it's actually rather unfortunate. And this is the motivation for trying to do things differently. So the first example is that of asbestos. So asbestos started, production began in the early 1880s. And then this timeline here showing a series of regulatory actions and showing some important medical revelations that revealed that asbestos is really harmful, especially to human health. And we're still dealing with the after effects today. And in fact, the CNEN News, so this is the magazine that comes out every week by the American Chemical Society. This just showed up in my mailbox earlier this week. Asbestos is still a global threat. I was shocked that this we're still talking about asbestos today. But a couple of facts that I pulled from the article is, you know, 125 million people are the number of people that are still exposed each year to asbestos, and we're still mining it at a pretty alarming amount. 2 million metric tons per year are mined. Okay, so an example of what not to do in asbestos, but the list goes on, right? There's a number of chemicals that I'm sure you've heard about as environmental engineers that we need to be concerned about. And the story is the same with all of them, that the inherent hazard of these substances was not comprehensively considered when they were designing or developing them for whatever the intended function was. And what this does is it leads to environmental, human health, but also economic and business consequences that we want to try to avoid. And it's not just with materials and chemicals. We can think about products as well. So compact fluorescent light bulbs, which is something that now exists in all of our homes and these buildings. The idea was that the benefit was reducing use phase energy demand. You extend the light bulb lifetime, and in all of that, you're saving money, right? Through the saved energy. You don't have to buy your light bulbs as often. But in order to get these benefits, you have to use mercury. And mercury is a known neurotoxin, and it has to be mined. So you have upstream impacts associated with having to gain that mercury and use it in these compact fluorescent light bulbs. The last example I'll show is that of solar panels. Solar's great, right? We're capturing a renewable energy source. We're reducing emissions associated with fossil fuels. But in doing so, we have to use a bunch of elements here. So I tried to highlight the ones that are commonly used in solar panels. And this being the periodic table of endangered elements, also produced by the American Chemical Society. So based on how abundant the sources of these metals are. So red being the most endangered or scarce elements. So we're relying on elements that are insecure future supply. And again, you have mining. You have to mine these out of the ground. So there's immense upstream impacts associated with them. All right, so how can we take these lessons learned and do things differently with nano? So the examples that I showed highlight two key shortcomings. The first being that we're designing for function only, right? We're not considering the hazard while we design these chemicals. And we're designing without consideration of that complete life cycle. That was the light bulb and the solar panel example. So my suggestion is if you think about these not as shortcomings, but as opportunities for sustainable design, we can think about design for function and hazard, and we can think about design while considering the entire life cycle rather than just the use phase. And these are the two primary research questions or opportunities that drive the research that I do. And then today I really only have time to focus on designing with consideration of the entire life cycle. Okay, so before I jumped into some results and the research I do, you know, I wasn't exposed to life cycle assessment until I was a graduate student. So I figured I would just provide a brief overview of what life cycle assessment is as a framework to hopefully then enable you to understand some of the results of work that I do better. Okay, so when we talk about the life cycle of a product or a process, we're considering not only the use phase, but we think of everything upstream from extraction to processing to manufacturing, and then downstream, end of life. And we're considering all of the inputs that go into each of these stages, the transportation between each of these stages. So these can be energy, water, materials. And then all of the emissions that are coming out of each of these stages. So it's waste, but it's all of your, it can be your product, it can be CO2 emissions. And then this showing here, your recycle loop. So this is your standard life cycle of a product or process. And then when you talk about life cycle assessment, this is a framework, it's also a tool that has three primary stages to it. Goal and scope definition, inventory analysis, and impact assessment. And at each of these stages, you're interpreting the results that you get, and you'll notice that there's all sorts of different feedback loops. It's an iterative process. It's by no means linear at all. And I will go through a simple example here of how you might apply life cycle assessment. Okay, so first, the goal and scope definition, as they suggest, right? Your goal, that's what's the aim or objective of your study and how are the results going to be used. The scope, this defines what you want to include, right? So it is nearly impossible to include the largest of scopes, and I'll show you here with a cup as an example. It gets infinitely more uncertain the larger your scope is, and so you have to be very realistic about how you define what it is you're going to study. You want to look at or define what your alternatives are, what environmental impacts you're interested in. The functional unit is really important to define because that's what everything's going to be normalized to. Whether you're going to consider temporal and spatial coverage, technology coverage, and major assumptions. So these are all considered as you outline the project or the assessment that you want to do. So step two is your inventory. This is where you spend most of your time in a life cycle assessment. So I'm showing here an example. Let's just take a cup, right? It can be made of either paper or polystyrene. And the processes that I'm going to consider are the raw materials, the forming, the finishing, the packaging, all of that that goes into the life cycle of making this cup, and then whether you throw it away or recycle it. We have all the raw material energy inputs. We have energy and process, energy associated with the processing aids and the equipment that you use. You have all the wastes and solids, and that's to waste to air, so your air emissions, and then you have your water emissions, or you might have emissions to your soil. And the functional unit, so it defines the function that your product serves. So in this case, I'm saying it's going to hold liquid, but it's specifically going to hold 100 milliliters of liquid. All right, so when you do your inventory analysis, you know, I have my functional unit, and that serves as my reference flow. And then you're going to go through sort of an initial flow diagram and get increasingly more and more detailed. So if we look just at this cup, our initial flow diagrams for paper versus polystyrene. So you're starting with either trees or you're starting with a product, a byproduct of oil and gas refining. You harvest, right? You drill. You go through all of the different stages all the way to landfill or recycling for all of them, but you have different byproducts along the way, different inputs along the way, depending on what your cup is made out of. So these are your initial flow diagrams. If, say, for example, you want to, or at the next stage, you have to get to more detailed flow diagrams. I'm only going to show one, but I'm outlining here what I'm showing, just styrene production. All right, so we have our gas or naphtha gas coming in, we have our styrene, and then our styrene production, our styrene coming out as our product. Within the styrene production now, you have a number of different processes and products that you're looking at. So this is your detailed flow diagram that you create for both initial flow diagrams for each of the different materials that make up your cup. All right, so I'll spare you the details of all of that, but what you end up getting is some results. So you get how much total electricity went into making it, how much coal you might have used, oil, gas. So this is all depending on where you are, maybe in the country, what the mix of your source of energy is. You have your pulp use. And then you have emissions, right? As CO2 emissions, SOx, NOx. So your accounting, it's really an accounting step. You're taking everything that's going in and out and you're putting a number to all of that. So we have these results in terms of our fundamental units, or sorry, fundamental elements. So then the next step is to conduct an impact assessment. And all that is it's taking your results and it's translating them into midpoint categories. These are your environmental or human health problems. So ecotoxicity, climate change, eutrophication, human toxicity, there's some endpoints there, land use impacts. So depending on the method or the model you use to do this translating, you'll have some different categories, but they generally fall in this range. And then you can use, there are some models that exist that enable you to go from midpoint impacts to endpoint impacts. So this is more environmental and human health damages. They kind of aggregate them even further. Okay. That was life cycle assessment. You can spend an entire year and you can spend multiple courses on life cycle assessment, so I just touched the surface of it. But hopefully it gives you a good enough background to dig into some of the work that I do. So remember the light bulb, right? So I talked about those, the light bulbs and the solar panels. So we're using engineered nanomaterials. They're embedded in these products. And we want to make sure that along the way we take into account all of the embedded resources, the potential emissions and release of these materials or their byproducts to avoid damages to the environmental, to the environment and human health. And coming back to this question, how do we harness all this good without the bad? And when I was thinking about this, this is a couple years ago now, you know, it was like, how do we come up with a way to quantify these impacts and the benefits in a way that I can compare them to be able to say, this product is worthwhile to continue developing, and we're not going to end up in the situation like we do with our CFLs or our solar panels or asbestos. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to avoid. So how do we quantify these impacts and benefits in a way that informs design to ensure that we maximize the potential for a net benefit rather than a net impact? And so I developed what's called this impact benefit ratio, and it's very simple on the surface, right? So you have your life cycle impacts and you have life cycle benefits. The goal is to maximize this ratio, which would indicate that you should pursue development and implementation, right? If you have a ratio less than one, or maybe this product really doesn't add any value and we shouldn't be nano-enabling this product at all because we're going to do more harm than good. But as I mentioned, we just went through sort of what quantifying life cycle impacts entails, and it can be pretty complex, and similarly for the benefits. So I've applied this IBR, impact benefit ratio, to nano-enabled sensors, nano-enabled textiles, and nano-enabled products in agriculture. And I'll focus on the nano-enabled textiles, and if I have time, I'll talk about some of our recent work looking at agriculture. All right, so the nano-silver-enabled t-shirts, all right, so we're adding nano-silver to textiles. This exists. There's socks, there's sporting equipment, there's hospital gowns, sheets, there's composites that you would use, kitchen utensils that have nano-silver embedded in it because it's naturally antimicrobial. And so in this t-shirt, the idea is that you prevent growth of odor-causing bacteria, so your clothing smells less, and consumers don't have to wash their clothes after every wear. And so these textiles were being promoted as an environmental benefit by reducing consumer laundering. I won't even touch on the behavioral components of these. I'm not sure who would actually, yeah. Anyway, so roll with me here. So the functional unit here is the number of lifetime launderings, and the impacts that I'm concerned with, because I'm trying to figure out when should I nano-enable this product, is adding the impacts associated with adding nanosilver to this textile. All right, so it's acquiring the precursor salt, it's the manufacturing, and it's the potential release of this silver to the environment. And again, I'm trying to identify scenarios where it's advantageous to develop this technology. Just briefly, so we looked at a number of different scenarios. Because we're focusing on reducing energy or the environmental sustainability of achieved through reduced washing, we looked at regular efficiency machines, high efficiency machines, and line dry. So these are different scenarios that we considered, and we also considered cotton versus polyester as our material. So these are our midpoint impacts. I'm not expecting you to actually read each of these plots. What I want you to take away from this is that for each of these plots, they represent an impact, different impact category. And you have your impact unit, your washing scenario that I just went through. But if you look across each of the impacts, you'll notice that the colors, which represent the stage of the life cycle of this textile, they shift, as well as the total magnitude based on the different scenarios. Okay? So if we look just at global warming potential, what you'll see is that the way in which you launder your t-shirt has a huge or significant impact on the overall global warming potential, measured as carbon kilograms of CO2 equivalents that are emitted. Okay, so whether you use your regular efficiency or your high efficiency, that significantly influences the impact of your CO2 emissions. Whereas if you compare these four scenarios with these four scenarios, the only difference being that you have silver or no silver, the silver is not really influencing the global warming potential of these two different options. Okay? So the main driver for global warming potential is the laundering habit. So you might say, okay, well, there's a pretty good potential if people are actually washing their shirt less, you know, that there might be a sustainable advantage to nano-enabling. But if we look at something like ecotoxicity potential, so the silver here being representing the silver ion release to the environment, the error bars representing the range in initial silver that we found from the literature, silver does have a significant impact on the ecotoxicity potential, whereas your laundering habits have relatively, compared to the global warming potential and compared to silver, a relatively insignificant contribution. So as we look across different impact categories, the major contributors will be very different. So what we wanted to do is figure out what reduction in number of launderings will it require to achieve a net benefit. And to do this, we set up a simple relationship. This is your conventional t-shirt, and we said, okay, we'll wash it 100 times. That's our lifetime of our t-shirt. And then we have our silver-enabled t-shirt, and we're going to wash that Z times. We're solving for Z. On the nano-enabled t-shirt, going a little bit deeper, right? So you have all this silver that is mined, refined, the synthesis. We have this is your initial silver concentration that's in your textile. You're laundering Z times. And then this is the release of the silver. And the K is your release constant. The textile, the transport, and the disposal, those are common across both t-shirts. So what this enables us to do now is we're looking back at global warming potential. And we're looking at the two laundering scenarios, the two extremes of our laundering scenarios. And what we are able now to define is our net benefit region. So those scenarios in which we're able to achieve a net environmental benefit looking at global warming potential. We're also able to define the maximum allowable silver. So that's how much silver you're able to put in your t-shirt to still have the potential to realize a net benefit. So we're defining the parameter space in which we should be designing. So since the high efficiency line dry has a comparatively lower magnitude of impact, that's why you see your different slope here. And you have a much lower maximum allowable silver compared to your regular efficiency laundering scenario. So that's the reason for the two different slopes in your lines. Now, if we look at something like ecotoxicity, a couple things come out. First of all, you still have the difference in your different laundering scenarios. The curve looks a little bit different because you have an exponential in the ecotoxicity component of the relationship, we're at two orders of magnitude lower a maximum allowable silver. All right, so again, we're finding important parameters around which we can define how to design these textiles more sustainably. Okay, so we wanted to go one step further here. Because we had such a range in initial silver concentrations in these shirts, common in life cycle assessment is to do an uncertainty analysis to figure out how influential is that uncertainty on the results that you achieve. So in this particular case, we decided, so you're still solving for Z. Our initial silver concentration ranged from 0.9 to almost 22,000, and again, that was based on what we found in the literature. And then the release constant was, so that's how much silver is being released, either 1% or 99%. And then what the results look like here, so we built a model, ran a Monte Carlo simulation to then come up with some different results, a nice rainbow scale here, indicating the number of lifetime launderings, so 0 to 100, 100 being no reduction in launderings is necessary to realize that benefit, and 0 or red being you can never launder the t-shirt in its lifetime if you wanted to realize that benefit. So red, bad, blue, good, red's taking up a lot of space here. So I guess the main point from this, I went through that real quick thinking that it wasn't. So realization of your net benefit is not straightforward, and it will be challenging to achieve for certain impact categories. So this is the global warming potential versus the ecotoxicity that I'm showing here. Do I have until 3?
Yeah, we need to be out of the room at 3.
At 3, okay. I'm gonna try to wrap this up then.
Okay.
But we can begin to define the parameter space in which we should be designing, right? So low initial concentration of silver, and at this low release constant, we're actually able to realize an added net benefit. All right, so how much nano silver do we need to achieve that desired functionality, right? Killing the microbes that cause the odor in your clothes. So here along the x-axis, you have your silver micrograms per gram in a textile. Here you have your bacterial reduction. So 100% means 100% of that bacteria is dead when it's dosed with this concentration of silver. So if you look up at 100%, we're at less than 2.5 micrograms per gram. So why are we still designing up here, right? And now that we know that the ecotoxicity potential is driven by how much initial silver we have in that textile, right? So, I will wrap up. I won't really go into the agricultural component, and I'm happy to talk about that with you afterwards if you're interested. But just to say that we've started looking at the use of nanomaterials in the agricultural sector, which is on the rise because of this infuse. It's this food, energy, water nexus, and the use of nanomaterials to try and reduce the energy demand for agricultural production, purify and reuse non-traditional sources of water for irrigation in agriculture. And a wide range, again, of applications. But when you're talking about agriculture, I mean, you have a direct line for both environmental exposure, and then if it gets taken up by the food, then we're eating it. So the risk is real. And so I've been really interested, and we have a review paper that we just submitted, in applying this trade-off analysis to the agricultural sector. I'll just skip over these pretty pictures. And the punchline is that when should you nano-enable products? And it really depends. Depends on the technology or the product that you are enabling. It depends on the nanomaterial that you're talking about. and it depends on your design. But the point being that you can use life cycle assessment, which is something that I recognized as a purely experimentalist going into graduate school, is that I can really use life cycle assessment to inform my design. And I can determine when it's advantageous to use nanomaterials so that in the lab I can design nanomaterials that should be used and I can promote their use in beneficial applications. So acknowledgement of the work that I presented today. The textile work was done by collaborations with University of Illinois Chicago. And then the agriculture work was completed by two of my graduate students, PhD students at Pitt. And again, I'm happy to talk more about that afterwards, but I did want to leave just a couple minutes for your questions, of course, information on how to contact me, and then information on our department. So I am in the Civil Environmental Engineering Department. We have about 150 graduate students, 50 of which are PhD students, the rest of which are master's students. The Environmental Engineering, Water Resource, and Sustainable Engineering faculty I have pulled out here. So Carla Ng, Vikas Khanna, Su Liang, our department chair, Radoslav Vidic, Melissa Bellick, myself, and then Kyle Bibby. And our research ranges from microbiology, viral water treatment work to systems level work looking at impacts on bee pollinators. So it's a very diverse department. I'll encourage you to go to our website, check out our research fields. A lot of us have different personal websites that you can check out the research we do. And if you are interested, do not hesitate to reach out to any of us. And if there's somebody else that you're interested here, I'm happy to be the liaison and connect you if you would prefer. But please check us out, and if you're interested at all, get in contact with us. So with that, I'll wrap up and happy to answer questions.
Okay, so we have about 7 minutes for questions, and then also Dr. Wilson said she was going to hang around a little bit after. Mm-hmm. Let's have questions now if you have any.
Don't be shy.
Jay.
Yeah.
Whenever you go about nano-enabling textiles, is that before they're already in the cloth, or is that you just dip the fabric in something?
Yeah, so that's a great question, because the release is really dependent on how you incorporate the particles into the textile. And there are a number of different ways to do that. And so you mentioned dipping. So people do just take the textile and they will dip it into a silver solution. Usually there's some surfactant in there to get it to adsorb, essentially. There's others that are actually making the fibers with the silver embedded in it. Of course, the release of those fabrics are much lower. So it depends. And there's people that are And the information is proprietary, so you can't always get it. But there's a number of different methods to incorporate the silver. And it does have a significant influence on the downstream ecotoxicity potential. Yeah?
So besides the agriculture, what other applications or fields do you see nanotechnology making advances in the next 50 years?
Yeah, so that's a wonderful question. And I would say the energy sector for sure. So that's something that is, so agriculture I would say is relatively new, and we're definitely headed in that direction. And I'm both excited and nervous about that. The energy sector is something that people have been looking at for at least 10 years now, if not more. And that's with battery applications, these flexible, wearable sensors and things like that. They have huge advantages to offer, and I think that would be, that's going to be where they would, in the next 50 years, have the greatest impact. Electronic components in your computers, more energy efficient phones, longer battery life in your phones, things like that. Yeah, great question. Yeah.
Is the kind of concern about downstream further? Exactly. Yeah, and there's a couple papers out there that have looked at specifically the influence of the right. So this, as far as I know, the CFL, use of CFLs was a result of a government action, and people have looked at specifically how that has influenced the mercury cycles globally, and it's amazing. People don't recycle their light bulbs. Even though you can go into Home Depot and you can recycle them, there's not a great system for that. And we didn't think that far ahead, I don't think, when we implemented them. So now I'm thinking of what your initial question was. What was your
question? It's like the impacts are more downstream.
They are, exactly. Yep, so they're more downstream. People are throwing them away. They're not recycling them. So we're not recovering that mercury. Yeah. Yeah.
What's the cost to like incorporate the other materials?
Yeah. So it depends on which application you're talking about. Nanomaterials, by and large, are more expensive now. Cost is coming down. I mean, just in my time and working with carbon-based nanomaterials, I've seen costs come down orders of magnitude. You can get like a kilogram now for like $5 or something of multi-wall carbon nanotubes, whereas before it might have been like $200. So as manufacturing advances, the cost is coming down. Capacity for making them increases, cost comes down. You're not going to get, you know, people are trying to get away from the metal, so like platinum, gold. Gold's a really great, it has a number of really great detection properties, so use in sensors, particularly we found in the agricultural sector. Really efficient, low detection limits, optical detection limits, you can actually see when something is present at a low concentration. But it's expensive, so there's no doubt that cost is definitely a factor. And when you're talking about environmental applications, that's a huge factor, especially water treatment. But people are moving over to ozone, so they're spending billions on transitioning as a town over to ozone versus fluorination. And there's potential for nanomaterials to offer an advantage over that.
When you approach an LCA project, where do you expect to see important uncertainties? And where in the project do you expect to see like, you know, values that are just like, we know what that value is, and there's no important uncertainty there?
We were just talking at lunch about how life cycle assessment's so dangerous because you only need to know a little bit to get a result. There's a huge amount of uncertainty. And it's in the data. So the results are only as good as the data that you input. And data acquisition, that's why I said a lot of time spent in the inventory stage. Trying to get good data that is reliable is challenging. And that's where most of the uncertainty lies. Depending on what your problem is you're trying to go after, it'll reveal itself in different places. Sometimes you can anticipate it, but other times you cannot. So they're kind of fun. You go in thinking you're going to get one answer, and oftentimes surprises pop up. A lot of people do just impact assessment to determine hotspots. They call it hotspot identification. So where along your process, so like a company might be interested in lowering their carbon footprint. And so you would go in, do a life cycle assessment of all their processing and say, you know what, guys, like, all this coffee you're making in the morning through your Keurig, like, that's 100 times more CO2 emissions than, like, whatever, you know, industrial process you're using, you know? So it can help guide companies as well, and there's consulting firms that just focus on that sort of stuff, so.